is presented by Betano. The game starts now. Here are your hosts, Brent Wallace, Jason York, and Bobby Ryan.
Happy Tuesday, everybody. Brent Wallace alongside you with Bobby Ryan and Jason York as the Bobby Ryan birthday week continues here on the show. By the way, just as a heads up, Bobby, no gift for you. We have no budget to send you any gift over the border.
That's okay. I can always hit mute. That's a gift in itself.
Touche.
Good morning,
Yorkie,
boys.
How are you today?
I'm good, Wally. Yeah, feeling good. Time change, though. I don't know about you guys. It's still getting up in the mornings. It's still a little weird, isn't it? Time change.
Well, maybe we should stop
bit.
Doing the show at 5:30 a.m.
Hey, listen, we got things to do. Kidding. Bobby's got tea times to make, friends to entertain, money to win on the golf course.
It's 31 degrees today. All the courses are shut down around here. We're in a freeze warning for all of Nashville because it's 31 degrees. So
shut it
nothing
down.
Special to, I got the fireplace guy coming in a little bit to get me dialed in. It'll be a nice day. Fire will be crackling.
Can't you just
noon.
Turn the TV on? Put the fireplace on the TV.
Yeah, yeah. That's the date move, eh? Come on over. The fire's going.
YouTube.
Just so you know, it's day five for me without Lisa around, so I'm pretty much exhausted. It's the longest stretch she's ever gone away and left me here. So, thoughts and prayers to me as I try to battle through walking the dog 9 times a day.
The house is still standing, though.
It is. I even barbecued yesterday. Life is good here at the resort.
Not bad.
Probably barbecue every night. You've probably barbecued every night because you don't know how to use a stove.
I'm not bad at cooking. It's when I want to. That's the problem.
Yeah.
So I just pretend I don't know how to use anything. I pretend I don't know how to do laundry so that I can never do the laundry.
Well done. That's the play right there. Move. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll shrink everything, but go ahead, babe.
Yeah. If you want me to, you may never see your socks again. Let's get on to the show as the Sens wrap up there. Their 5-game road trip tonight in Edmonton. As of right now, we don't know the status on Matthew Joseph or Thomas Chabot, but I just checked. As of right now and this morning, they weren't added to the IR as of right now, so I'm assuming, as it looks, either they're not playing today or they're fine. I know that's not very helpful, but it just doesn't look like it's been added to the IR. So no call-ups yet either. They do have a couple of extra bodies, obviously, on the road. So we will get to lock of the day with Edmonton coming up later in the show. There are some things to discuss, and one of them, Yorkie, as always, you like to break down some video. And so I spent 23 hours yesterday coming up with a new graphic for Yorkie Vids. But before we get to that, let's get our sponsor reads out of the way. And I'll see if you're paying attention as we get through these. Alex, first we're going to call for, let's start off easy with Renfrew Pro Tape, and I'm going to give it to Yorkie.
Well, thanks again to our sponsor, Renfrew Pro Tape. Oh, God, get the marbles out of my mouth. The show is always held together by Renfrew Pro. It's the one with the green core. Fridays, pre-tape Fridays. Don't forget about that. RenfrewPro.com, available at all major retailers.
That's a 3.
Yeah,
I know.
That's
sponsored.
Like, you didn't even give a crap
thing.
About that.
Yeah,
like I wasn't, a little more excitement.
I wasn't.
When it comes to the number one tape in hockey, it's Renfrew Pro Tape.
Listen, everybody knows.
I didn't feel much
best.
Heart. Yeah, there wasn't a lot of heart involved in that one.
When you say the one with the green core, you have to mean it.
Yeah. A little power behind
it. Listen, if they've got no competition, there's no other tape like it. Like, everybody knows it.
That's fair.
Okay.
Trust me.
Let's
just say that next
boring.
time.
Next up, our good friends at BEI.
This is me here.
Yeah, I switched it up for you.
All right. Another special thank you. Another shout out to one of our other sponsors, Bonnechere Excavating. Heavy. See, Yorkie, you just started us off like, and I'm going to get a five now because of you. BEI, Bonacher Excavating. Heavy civil general contractor helping to shape the Ottawa Valley. When planning your next project, consider BEI for your aggregate supply needs. Again, as always, hiring across the board in any capacity that you can get yourself down there to. The website's bonacherexcavating.com. And give them a dial, 613-432-1120. Bonacher Excavating, helping to shape the Ottawa Valley. Yorkie, you just started me right down the right. Like, you know, you buried me, pal.
You had an eight going just until the end.
Right at the end there?
And if you'd mentioned, like, great HR where you get to play hockey on Fridays, that might have been a selling point, part. Too.
I forgot that part.
That would have been good. And finally, our presenting sponsor is none other than Betano. Go to betano.ca. Use the app and have an amazing world of sports always with you at Betano. Hundreds of betting options for events, same game parlays with Bet Builder, live in-game betting, and the most competitive odds in the market. Betano, the game starts now.
8.8.
That's an easy 12.
Yeah, oh. Nice. Well done. What's your specialty?
All right, let's get on with it, shall we? I know Alex is busy in the back, but Alex, it's time to roll in now, if we can, the new animation for the video room.
That's so good. Oh, God. I look at him 5'6", little tiny body, giant head. I look like George Costanza with hair. Well done. I like it, Wally.
Very. I love the satellite on the side. Well done, guys.
Yeah.
Don't forget, there is the Bobby Ryan bobblehead on the shelf, just so that in case there was any concern that you weren't present in the video room.
Yeah. Oh, there it is. Okay. I feel like I'm playing Where's Waldo looking for that.
Yeah. There we go. Okay. Time for you geniuses to break down some video. We're going to go to the Calgary game. Didn't go quite in Ottawa's favor. Let's show some plays, shall we?
We're going to start from the top here, Wally. I think we're just going to show the first three goals of the game. You know what's interesting about this game, guys? We go back to it. There were two goalposts and one goal called back because of an offside. So this is the one I always scratch my head off. On a one draw, because the Ottawa Senators win that puck back, right? I always hate this as a defenseman. How the hell did two guys jump by the forwards? You end up with a 2-on-1. So stop it there for a sec. So right away, your D goes into pinch. And Bobby, maybe you can tell on the wingers here, are they just... like, how do their guys jump by them on this play? Like, how does this? It's a bad pinch right away, right?
Yeah.
But how does this turn into like
this is a bad pinch. The only person that really gets a pass. Straight up. Yeah, the only one that gets a pass from me is Brady because he's what you call. I mean, he's the gunner. No matter what he's going through, like his last thing to do is to hold up. Because you're on the power play, any lost draw, you need that immediate pressure. So he gets a pass and then he's kind of getting to a spot because right now he's thinking, oh, we're fine. The puck's won. The only thing Pinto actually won the battle. The puck just got, chipped by him. Sanderson's up too much. Three breakdowns right out of the gate there. And then you can go into the rest of the play, but they didn't so much get jump past as Brady tried to shoot through and shoot that gap and get in there. And then, G's guy beat him up the ice, but G's thinking he won the draw. So he's not seeing any of that kind of stuff.
Yeah. So if we go back on this, Alex, here's what I don't like. So stop it right here. So right there. And this is, I know what they're doing. They're really pressuring Ottawa down ice because they know they've got a forward back there that can't defend. And in this point, it's DeBrincat. And if you look at the Ottawa Senators in this position, I'm a big proponent of you have to protect the middle of the ice. So right here, Ottawa had great position. You have your defenseman in front, DeBrincat's right there, and then Pinto's back there. So all three players have inside position on the ice. This all starts with a very bad defensive play by DeBrincat. He doesn't even need to go at him there. If he just would have held his ice held his ice and not make that big swoop, nothing bad happens here. And this is, for me, when it all happens, go back right here, DeBrincat, right there, just stay. But that play, and then the guy comes in late, but they go from protecting the middle of the ice to me to leaving the middle of the ice wide open. It all happens to me with the little swoop, just stop, and nothing bad happens. But this is, hey, Bobby, it's the old drive-by. Here you go.
Anything but what you did.
Just
do anything but
just,
what you did.
Just stop.
Where are
and
you
then
going?
Not only does he do a drive-by, he goes to the boards. So
he just kept skating to the bench.
Yeah, so that's the thing. If you're going to go with four forwards, then once you're back in your own zone, you have to make a conscious effort to play some kind of defense. So, again, all back, middle of the ice, one swoop. Pinto has his guy. So, to me, this plays all on DeBrincat, and it's 1-0, and he knows it too. Like, guys aren't stupid. You go to the bench, you're like, I can't be doing that. So, 1-0, and again, a surety, and Ottawa Twitter exploded after this one. It was to the point in this game where Ottawa wanted to start declining penalties, but that's a very easy. This has nothing to do with who's on the power play. Do we have two defense? Should Chychrun be on the point? Oh, Thomas Chabot, he's wrecking the power play. No, this is stops and starts, basic hockey 101. Stop, nothing bad happens.
Yep.
Bobby,
I
don't
agree more. That's, yeah. No, big swoop. And then the hard part there is Sanderson, because he's in no man's land, right? He can't go to the puck. He's just got to try to stay where he is. And then you got a guy streaming down the middle for a one-timer. I mean, he's got nothing. I guess the only thing I would have said is maybe he could have edged more towards going towards, you know, the goal scorer. But because Backlund's on his backhand out there, but you can't give him free rein to walk the net. So he's stuck. Pinto's got his guy back there. I mean, it all comes back to the big – I mean, if the DeBrincat just kind of – he doesn't even have to go towards the guy. Just either stop or keep him on the backhand outside the dots, and you're good to go.
Yeah.
All right, so, let me ask a question.
1-0. What's up?
So the Sens have given up, and we've talked about this, 7 shorthanded goals since the All-Star break. Is there a lack of accountability with this group?
So this is, I don't know, it's hard to say what's going on behind closed doors, but I'm sure DJ's got them in there every day, and he's in their face about the fact that you're not only not creating momentum or goal scoring right now on the power play, you're giving us a chance to lose by giving up shorthanded goals and deflating everything. So I don't know if it's a lack of accountability or if they're just so flustered because the power play has been so good and the strength of the team for so long that when it's not, everybody's running around. And that happens, right? You get to a point where you're not scoring, so you're really tight and you're trying to make something out of nothing all the time. So I think there's a little bit of that, but I don't think there's a lack of accountability when you have guys in the room like G, Chucky, you know, guys that are dragging other players into the fight. I don't think that's the issue here. I don't see that being the issue, and you can elaborate more, Yorkie. I just, with the group of guys that they have in there and some of the veteran presence, I don't think there's a lack of accountability by any means.
Well, if you'd say there's a lack of accountability from the coaching staff, well, DeBrincat got taken off the first unit, so they did change things up. And I'll guarantee you they weren't happy with that play. The only way to hold players accountable is you got to switch things up, change ice time. So, you know, people can blame Thomas Chabot, but if you look at the goals on what happens, that's an issue for me again of it's early in the game. It's 0-0. This is a huge game. And realizing that I'm in a zone right now where if I get beat, something bad's gonna happen. So it's just, again, it's that's the thing. When you have forwards on the point, they're not used to being in those situations around, especially wingers, right, Bobby, around the front of the net in your own zone. Oh, yeah. So it's a different thing. But no, I don't think there's a lack of accountability. Not at this time of year. I'll tell you right now. We said it yesterday. They are going over video. They're going over things. And to me, why is the power play not working? It's mental. This time of year, it is a mental thing. And they're getting chances. They're just not scoring. And it almost seems right after they miss, the other team's coming down and getting a shorty on them. So it's between the ears.
Yeah, very much so.
Okay, but Alex DeBrincat in that game played 20-53, which is the most he's played in 12 games.
Well, that's the problem. You're trying to come back in games because you're chasing the game. So,
right.
What do you do? Your scoring depth is so thin with your top six guys, and your bottom six don't produce that much. And when you look who's on your bottom six, you got a lot of guys that, hey, you got to try and win the game, right? So, I don't blame the coaches for doing that. It's you're trying to put the guys on you think that can score. And for the most part, too, DeBrincat's been a pretty responsible player. It's just he's going through a bad stretch right now.
Yeah, yeah. And it's heightened because they're losing, right? So we're here nitpicking right. and pulling them apart because yeah. they're losing and the right. season's running out. I mean, you're looking at it. They're running out of runway here. So every mistake gets magnified. That's just that's the nature of this time of year, yep. right?
Exactly. And that's fair because exactly. we went from talking about this power play being the best that's ever been assembled for the Ottawa Senators to being awful in seven games.
Yeah.
And now we're talking like we should never have these five guys on the ice ever again type thing. So no,
that's ridiculous, but that's what playing at this time of the year does. It's the games are heightened. Every little mistake becomes that more important versus the last 5 years when you're playing with you don't have this kind of pressure. And this is why I hate using this expression. This is why meaningful games are meaningful, because little mistakes
can't
matter.
Can't say that anymore.
Yeah.
But that's anyways. Let's go to the next goal here. I think we spent 20 minutes
on to number
on
two.
So again, in this position, you look at again the middle of the ice. Everything's pretty good. The centers are in the middle of the ice. And then it's blown coverage on the back door. So it seems they get stretched out when they don't need to. Bobby, I'll let you go first on this one again on what you're seeing here.
Well, you know what the general rule of thumb is on the penalty kill. When there's a bobbled puck or, a breakdown, like it's a broken entry. We'll start with that. And that broken entry gives every single player a chance to jump. That's rule number one. Broken entries and bobbled pucks, you jump. You force and you try to get them out. So everybody's forcing here. The only thing I would say is Zub makes a good play here. And this is an opportunity for him to go. And I don't have a problem with him going here, right? He's on the guy's ass. He's got a little bit of a gap. But he does go too high. And look at the center of the ice right now. Gambrell, obviously, I think is the other guy. He goes down to cover, but he leaves the coverage to go back on this play. And that's you have to stay there. And I know he's looking at 49 in the middle of the ice going, okay, here's a guy, but that guy's not a one-timer threat. And you got a 200 goal scorer in Lindholm standing there, with his stick in the rafters waiting for a pass. You cannot leave that guy. If everybody jumps and everybody moves, but they do get settled down when Toffoli makes this play, you have to recognize that, okay, they're settled. I have a guy. I'm covering a guy. Stay. Just stay right next to your guy, and you don't let a goalie get backdoored. Another main staple of the rule. But when you leave that guy, you have no opportunity. And Zub can't go that high, and Gambrell can't leave his guy. So there's a couple little breakdowns. But I don't have a problem with anything they do up until this point, and you can elaborate more again. But I just – they're fine right now. Just stay where you are and don't leave a guy that door like that.
Well, there's –
you could have stopped that puck and walked it into the net.
Remember the rule? So all coaches, they have a saying when you're supposed to go on the penalty kill. It's called eyeballs and assholes. If you can see the player's eyeballs, if you can see the player's eyeballs, which means he's facing you and he has puck control, you never go. But if he's turned to you and you see his ass, what they call asshole, then you go at him. The only thing with defensemen, I think once that puck is over the top of the circles, you don't want to go. The only time, so when Zub goes here, stop it. Keep it going until Zub finally goes here. So right here, stop it. He's got no chance of getting that puck. There's zero chance. So that's when you got to make a conscious decision and use your hockey sense. If I go here, what's my chances to get in the puck? Not very good. And look at the route he takes too. He's coming up the boards. And again, I always go back to, I always come back to the middle of the ice, and he's putting himself in a horrible position here. So to me, top of the circles, if I'm a defenseman, I'm not going here. I'm going to stop, and I'm going to retreat back to the middle of the ice and live to fight another day. But that stretches out the entire box right away, and now everyone's got to make a decision. So there's no way you can get back in time, and you're right, 27, Gambrell, he jumps up, but these are such split-second decisions where you're trying to do the right thing, and that guy's not on a one-timer position. That's why he shouldn't go, but it's just, this is how you score on the power play. Get them stretched out, all starts here, bad play by Zub, and then it just it compounds into that. So eyeballs and assholes, yeah. That's the saying for today.
I'm going to ask you this question, and it's not to be negative. It's just a curious thing of, we talked about this time of year and playing games that they're not winning, so they're trying to fight for their playoff lives. Is this a team that's just making these mistakes because they're trying so hard to get right back in the game right away?
I believe so. I think when you start to lose a little bit, you start to, and again, a lot of these guys haven't been in this position at this time of year, but the panic button's a lot easier to hit. And I think that they're looking at it like, hey, we're down by one, we're down by two, we're still in it, but we're going to forget to pay attention to detail and chase offense. And that's not the way to win at this time of year. You almost have to be more patient than you ever are and win the game in the third period, right? And chip away at it. And they're not doing that. They're cheating for offense, and it's costing them, you know, 3 and 4 goal leads after that.
Yeah. And Zub's another great example of a guy that's never really played in this kind of atmosphere. He's always been dependable and he doesn't make a lot of mistakes. And last couple of weeks, I've seen him kind of un-Zub-like. You're seeing some turnovers. Yeah. You're seeing some decisions like that. And again, he's a guy, like, he's older, but as far as NHL experience goes, he doesn't have a lot. So he's going to learn from these situations as well.
I think we're going to see him here shortly on another clip. And I thought the same thing about him in that one. So, and it's not to call the player out, because I do think at times he's their most dependable guy back there on the defensive side of the puck. So yeah. 100%. Yeah. He's getting exposed a little bit, and it's a lesson by fire, right? That's all it is, really.
Well, yeah, without further ado, I guess without further ado, if you will.
Poor Zuber. I love Zuber. He's usually such a dependable guy. This one, though, this whole play for me.
Okay.
I'll just go quick to start it off here, Bob. That's a pretty fortunate goal there for Huberto. That was a double deflection. But it all starts, two things for me that stick out on this play. Pinto has to get this puck deep. Zuber probably, again, leave the middle of the ice. Bad things happen, but that is very fortunate tip. But this all starts right here. But I'll say this, sometimes you got to give credit to their team. Look how good the gap is there. By the
gap's incredible.
You talk about a great gap, and a lot of guys, Pinto thinks he has more time to turn around and spin and then chip it deep. But great gap causes the turnover. And then watch Shabbat's line there. If you can go back to what Shabbat does there, guys. Again, it's middle of the ice. When you leave the middle of the ice, watch Shabbat's route. Defensemen are taught in the neutral zone, when you are going to regroup and regain ice, and it's tough because he's already in the middle of the ice, but he goes from the middle of the ice to the outside of the ice. And then he has zero time to recover because of the route he takes with his skating. But everybody thought Pinto was going to get this puck deep. He doesn't get it deep because it's a great gap by the defenseman. Shabbat, the only thing I'll say about Shabbat, my last thing here, Bobby, I'm not sure why he's joining the play there, because there's not much offense that's going to come from what Pinto is doing. Best case scenario, this is going to be a dump in by Pinto. And Shabbat is so wide on the play. To me, it's the wrong time to support the play. Nothing good's happening from it. So bad play not to get it in, caused by the good gap. Shabbat's caught, 2-on-1. Shabbat or Zub leaves a little bit of the middle of the ice, and a very fortunate tip. Anything else you see there, Bobby?
Not a thing. I would say that would be a real big position for me if I'm Chabby to hold back and wait for something more to develop. And if you can be the fourth man in that rush, fine. You don't need to be the third. And again, you know, you break the whole goal down, and there's a lot of fortunate things that happen here for Calgary. It goes off Zub's shin pad right to a height where Huberto can just get a touch on it. This actually wasn't the goal that I was talking about. There was one where Zub made a play at a defensive blue line to step up into something that he shouldn't have. But nothing. This just comes down to a rookie mistake of being in a 2-1 game on the road. You know, you're 4th or 5 on the road. That puck's got to get deep. You got to put the work boots on and get back in the game the old-fashioned way. And you know, Pinto didn't do that, and it leads to breakdowns all over the ice. But and Chabby, you know, he's such a good skater that you almost give him the latitude to take that route because he's usually going to get back. But that route takes him 15 feet out of the play, and he ends up missing by 10, right? That's all that really comes down to. If he just takes a quick little button hook to the center of the ice, we're probably not talking about the goal. Nothing changes. The puck's got to get deep. I think this is the one here I was talking about. There's no – what are you doing, Zub? Like – you got a guy on the inside track of Parker Kelly there. There's no reason to move up into that play. Just let that play develop in front of you. Let Parker Kelly buy some ice here because he's got no chance. Look at this. This guy's flying down the middle. You have to know that Parker's beat. You have to know that you can just hold. Like a defensive responsibility in Yorkie, you know this. When you got numbers coming at you at speed, you just hold the center and wait for help. And he doesn't do that. He forces them into it. And the guy makes a nice little chip pass into space. But if you don't go there, you give up nothing. Absolutely nothing. You might give a shot off from the outside, and that's about it.
You see the big difference between Calgary and Ottawa, though, how tight Calgary's gap is on the Ottawa's forwards and how loose Ottawa's gap. Like, look where the defenseman is here and watch where Ottawa's defense are. That puck is on the other side of the red line, and the D are already back at the top of the circles. We're always taught as D to get up the ice, get your gap. And you look at the gap there by, I think it's Zub and Shabbat. They're so far back, and they're given so much time and space. And then it forces Zub to come forwards because he didn't establish a good gap initially. And I'm not sure why it wasn't even a line change, Bobby. They got to get a tighter gap. There's way too much space between Ottawa's forwards and Ottawa's defense, and it makes it way too easy for Calgary.
Yeah. Couldn't agree more.
Then can I ask, I got a question. How are you 66 games into the season and still dealing with this?
So with gaps, this is when you talk about back-to-backs. You got to work to get up ice. I just remember you'd be doing practice drills, 3-on-2 regroups, 3-on-2 regroups, and the D coach is with you. He's like, yelling, get up the ice. And when you're in practice, why is he yelling at me? We're tired here. But that's part of it. In a back-to-back scenario like that, it's easier not to get up the ice. And that's not a systems thing. That's not a coaching thing. That is a conscious decision by the defenseman that they're just probably a little gassed. I don't know what was going on with the shift length there because we caught the clip there. Maybe they were on the ice for an extended shift, but that's what happens when you have loose gaps. Loose gaps give time and space. And Bobby, hey, great thing to have time and space, right? Imagine you time and space all the time. You'd be putting up 100 points every year.
Right? Thank you very much. That'd be great. That'd be great. But
a D? Yeah. Hey, if a D's gonna charge you forwards at the blue line, you're gonna go, whoop, here we go.
Like thank you very much. But the fact that the guy that got the puck that made the pass had 10 feet of space at the offensive blue line to turn around and make the play that he wants. That gives you the impression of a terrible gap. And it was, and then you got a guy coming forward at you, and that's the easiest chip in hockey. You're just going to chip it by him and lay it into space. So there might've been fatigue. I don't know what the fatigue. And then on top of it, you're already down 3-1 and you're feeling like you're not getting back in the game. So there's that little loose casualness that you're like, okay, maybe the forwards will do it for us. So that's kind of what you're hoping for at that point.
The other thing too, when things are going badly for you, when you give up some 2-on-1s, when you're getting scored on, a lot of times just with psychologically with your brain, D will stay back. She's like, shit, I don't want to get beat. I'm going to stay back. Mm-hmm. But you make it worse. And you watch some good teams. the good teams stay up on the other team's forwards, but it's, hey, it's, there's a lot of different reasons for it. But I'm just for Zub, I'll say this again, a little bit of a drop off in his play lately. You usually don't notice Zub, and when you don't notice Zub, you like, he's had a great game, but now I'm noticing him again. Long season, who knows? Maybe he's banged up a little bit. He's played hurt this year, but he's a little un-Zub like for me lately.
Yeah, I agree.
I'm wondering if he's still battling through injury. Like, he's played, I think, 47 games this year. That's a very good point about perhaps. I mean, he did play 21-03 in that game. But I'm with you on what you notice from him. He's a very quiet player, which is exactly what you want. Those are the players that never get any attention. And you're like, when they're gone, you're like, we could use that guy right now.
Yeah,
he's such a smart guy. When he's so smart when he's playing well. He's just so smart, so under the radar. He does so many good little things. And hey, this is the thing. It's a tough friggin' game. Guys are gonna make mistakes. It happens all the time. Yep. We're nitpicking here, but this is the nitpicking time of year. Why are they losing? These are just examples of why.
Well, perhaps then we find a little positive in the way Jacob Chychrun has played. Has he played better than maybe you guys thought? Or I also know he plays in the other conference, which limits the access, and plays in Arizona, which limits it even more. Has there been any surprise to his game that you've noticed?
Not for me. I mean, not for me. I think he's come in and he's been good. He's moved the puck well. He's given them cleaner breakouts than they've had on, you know, different units back there. I always knew he skated well. I didn't know he skated as well as he did. He really, really is smooth and glides to areas very, very well. So I don't think I'm surprised. I think we're going to see a lot. If Chabby's down, we're going to really see exactly what he is and what his game can be, because he's going to be taking on a lot more minutes here going forward, is my guess. But no surprises for me. Steady player. Just makes the right play a lot of time, gives you a little bit of offense, has a bomb from the point when he wants to shoot it. So I think the scouting report's reflective of how he's played, right?
Yeah. And we got to remember, too, he's had pretty well zero practice time with the team. He's been thrown right into the fire here, into a very important part of the season. I think he's handled it extremely well. Like, he's come in. It was like a movie scripted debut at home with the goal and assist. He was one of the stars of the game. I think he's been really good. I watched him a lot early in his career, especially when coming out of junior. He used to try and force things a lot because he's such a great skater. Mm-hmm. He's so talented. He used to get caught running around a little bit. Now, I'll be honest, I hadn't watched him a lot in Arizona, but since his earlier times in the league, he's a lot more composed. His game's quieter. And hey, that's what happens after you played in the league for whatever he's played, 300-400 games. You relax, and the game, I like to call it, slows down for you. And it seems now he seems to be in a really good headspace as a player. And there's so many things to like about his game. And hey, he's made a few mistakes too, but again, they get magnified at this time of year. But overall, Bob, I agree. He's been really good.
Yeah.
Well, you know what the issue is sometimes for those guys? He's been considered a number one prospect and all that stuff since 14, 13. Like, he's been able to skate so well and dominate so early that he's never had to face that kind of, I guess, reeling back in, right?
Injuries,
and then you
too.
Get to the NHL where everybody's,
And he's had some injuries. So, like, for some me, it's some big ones, And even this year, how long did he have to sit out with Arizona before they traded him? Like, that's not easy. Yeah. Not playing hockey, when you're 3 weeks, like, he's coming in here right away, and I know they eased him in a little bit, but from not playing at all to coming in and playing, that's a big ask. So he's done very well, in my opinion.
I agree.
Well, I joke now because he's played the last two games over 24 minutes, so he's already ready to take over Thomas Chabot's role since – Chabby plays 25 minutes or more.
You running Chabot? Are you on the Chabot out of town?
No, that's not what I said.
What next
all I'm
for
saying
you?
Is if he. Oh, God, here we go. Okay, so, all right. Is
they're going to be after
Chychrun
you again.
If you had to pick If you had to pick one guy on your team, are you taking Thomas Chabot or Jacob Chychrun?
One guy for what? What's the question here? For to move on, to build my franchise with?
To build your defense around.
Right now, I'm taking Jake Sanderson because of his age.
Listen, can you just listen to the question?
He said one guy. Please. You said if you're taking one guy from
I gave the option, Thomas Chabot or Jacob Chychrun. Which guy are you taking?
I'm taking Chychrun because his contract's way better. It's way better. He's at under, and he's got you control the asset. Listen,
you're playing a beer league game tomorrow. Who are you taking as your top D?
Beer league game. I'm taking Chabot all friggin' day long. In beer league, come on, he's gonna light it up. Anybody that's made a decision right now on who the number one D is, who's better, who's worse. I need to see Jacob Chychrun play longer, and I need to see Thomas Chabot play down the stretch. Evaluating Chabot for the last 5 years, I want to see how he plays down the stretch here. I want to see how Chychrun plays down the stretch here. I've said this before. We've all said this. The best time to evaluate players is this time of year, and obviously the playoffs. I want to wait and see how the defense plays. By the end of the season, I will have your answer.
I agree. I don't think it's fair to either one of them to pick one based on, you know, Chychrun being here for five games and being a breath of fresh air when Chabby's been in the fire for a lot longer and has really carried the load for 5 years. And maybe he's not at his best right now. And I think everybody in Ottawa can agree with that. I think Chabby would be the first to tell you he's not playing his best hockey, but he's played a lot of hockey and he's played a lot of bad hockey. So habits have kicked in. You revert to habits when things aren't going well. So he's reverting back to habits that were cultured into him in a losing environment. And they're coming out of that losing environment. So I'd really, really like to see Chabby down the stretch play some good hockey, and then he can kind of build on that for next year. But I don't think it's fair to either one of them because Chychrun hasn't played here long enough either. He's running on fumes and adrenaline right now, and that's going to calm down a little bit as well. So it's a tough loaded question, but I'm taking Chabby right now. I love playing with him. He settles the game down so much for you.
Yeah. Jason,
how easy it was to answer that question.
I don't know what I can't evaluate Chychrun on five games. I can't.
Yeah.
I want to see him play tonight. How does he play against McDavid? This is a great game to watch and see how guys play against the best player in the world and arguably the second in Dreisaitl. So I think it's way premature to even have that discussion. You want to talk about evaluating players? I know we don't have time for this, but people that were evaluating DeBrincat the first five games, but now we've seen him for a full season. You got a better idea of what the player is. I need to see both play longer. Not answer until I see both players down the stretcher. And I will answer at the end of the season.
I'm going to get a fence sitting graphic for you. do you want to save DeBrincat until Thursday?
Because it's a longer conversation. If he scores two, we should.
Okay. We're going to move on. By the way, Jake Sanderson needs 1 point tonight to tie Erik Karlsson for third most points by a rookie for the Sens in franchise history. Does either one of you, this will be tougher for Bobby. He's going to put that graphic up. Does either one of you know who would be the leading rookie defenseman in points for the Ottawa Senators in the franchise history? Who has the most points as a rookie D-man in franchise history? This will be tough for Bobby because it's well before his time in Ottawa.
A rookie D in his first year.
So, which rookie D has the most points in franchise history?
In a season.
Well before me, but I'm taking a shot at Reds, but I don't know.
Wade Redden would be number two.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not Redden. I think it's, rookie D. God. I think it's before Wade Redden, Wally.
No, but 05, 06, they were actually D partners.
Oh, is it? It's not pricing.
Mezeros?
Oh, Mezeros. Oh. Yeah, that's who it is. That's ding, who ding, it ding, is. Ding, ding. Yeah.
Was that right?
Congrats, yeah. Bobby. Yeah.
Nice. Wow. Nice. I actually good thought his you. Name, but yeah, okay.
How yeah. many points, Wally?
Andre Mezeros.
What do you get?
He had 39 points. Reds had 30 and Erik Karlsson 26, Jake Sanderson 25.
Solid. Okay. Yeah, Mezeros had some, we saying Mezeros or Mezeros? It was always people said it different ways. How'd you do it? Mezeros. He put together a couple good seasons here.
Yep. Yeah. A little underrated. And then they made some changes. All right. Yeah. So time for lock of the day as we get to the Edmonton Oilers game as the Sens wrap up their 5-game road trip. Lock of the day, as always, brought to you by Betano, where the game starts now. Go to Betano, download the app, and play alongside our genius pickers. And the smartest man in hockey is still Jason York. Gentlemen.
Thank you.
I'm going to start with Yorkie for this.
Really? Okay. Well, I'm taking Edmonton. I've got Edmonton, McDavid. They're just coming off, I believe, a loss of Toronto, where they played very well. Edmonton still, like, they're a wild card team right now. That was a really important game for both teams, but Edmonton at home, they're flying at home all the time. I just think, you know, with the goaltending situation in Ottawa right now, you got two rookies back there. Do we know who the starter is yet, Wally? Has that been announced? Do we know who's starting in Nets?
For who?
For Ottawa?
Well, it's 6:25 in the morning out there, so probably not. Yeah, I'm guessing no.
DJ Smith never announces his starter anymore.
Is Sogard healthy enough to start? Years.
I don't know. Sogard. Because they didn't skate yesterday, so we don't know the update.
Regardless of who the goalie is, I'm taking Edmonton.
Okay.
Okay. I have to agree with you here. I'd love to go the other way to try and bridge this gap that I got between us, but I can't. I they're in a wild card spot. You got a guy with 125 points, which is just ridiculous. And then the second leading scorer in the league is right there on his line. So I don't think Ottawa is going to be able to contain him. I do think we're going to see a really good game out of Ottawa. They don't look defeated yet to me. They look like they're in every game. I think we're going to see one hell of a pushback by them, but it comes down to goaltending and special teams. If your power play is not going, you're not beating Edmonton. If you're giving up power play goals, and their power play is good in Edmonton, I don't see the depth here to really compete with them for 60 minutes. So I'm taking Edmonton.
Bobby, it's good to see you're taking your own advice and not trying to get it all back in one foul swoop like the Ottawa Senators. Right, you're playing the patient game. Well, you know when to.
I'm running out of time though.
still time.
Yeah,
still time. Here's a question I have though. So Ottawa's wrapping up a 5-game road trip, so they're tired, if you will, tired of being on the road. Edmonton's just coming home from a four game road trip. Is there anybody with an advantage in either one of those?
No, I think there's a fatigue on both levels because Edmonton came home, probably had a day off and relaxed. So there is that, but they're way more concentrated on a playoff fight than Ottawa is right this second. So I think this game means more to them. And this would be your classic trap game. I don't know how they did on the road. This would be your classic trap game, but I don't see it at this point in the year.
Edmonton went 2-2 and they gave up 18 goals in 4 games. They gave up 2-7 spots, one to Winnipeg and one to Toronto.
Yeah, this is the problem.
And this is the issue with the Ottawa Senators right now. I'll say it again. They're so young down the middle. So your matchups on the road right now. So you got Stützle playing against McDavid probably. Stützle is dynamic, unbelievable on the offensive side of the puck, but he's still learning the defensive side of the game. And it is so hard to be a center iceman down low against Connor McDavid's line. Like, that is tough. Like, hey, I'm not saying anything nobody knows. And then you got Nugent Hopkins, who's also a really tough guy. Derek Ryan is a really good depth centerman. So this is a big ask for Ottawa centers. Like, and this is end of the year, big games. They're just young. They're young down the middle. And hey, great experience, a great game to evaluate. But man, it's a big ask for Ottawa's centers to go against what you got down the middle in Edmonton.
Very much agreed.
So and Connor McDavid just that? Lights. Well, I just, I'm trying to point out just to help people with their, perhaps their betting decisions. Connor McDavid lights up Ottawa, right? 37 points. He's got the most points by an Edmonton Oiler against the Ottawa Senators in franchise history. 21 games. He's only been held pointless in four of those games against Ottawa. I don't believe tonight is going to be number five. So
no.
I'll go back to everybody saying I hate the Ottawa Senators as I pick the Edmonton Oilers. But I don't see a power play that's struggling. Again, a penalty kill that's not been great necessarily.
Yeah.
Well, I shouldn't say that. They've actually been pretty good, but they're facing the number one power play in the league. So yeah. Ottawa it is. Edmonton it is.
Yeah, yeah. The only way Ottawa wins this game is
making up anything here today.
Yeah, the only way they win this game is if their power play gets back on track. They get unbelievable goaltending and they stay out of the penalty box and don't get Edmonton. So if those three things happen, but that's a big ask.
They need a bottom six guy. Yeah, but this is the part where your power play, Wally, too, you go, you know what, we're 0 for 20, and tonight they go 3 for 4, and we're all sitting here on Thursday going, damn it.
So I never doubted the power play. Yeah.
No, then we're talking about how good the breakout was on that flank. but honestly, I hope they come out of it tonight. I do, but I just can't take them in good conscience.
Yeah, with you.
Okay, but they do play well against teams like Boston.
They do.
Maybe there is because there's such a heightened awareness of Dreisaitl and McDavid that they've got to step up. I don't know. I'd like to see them win that game, but boy, they're just facing an Edmonton team that just seems to have a lot more to play with than Ottawa does.
Agreed.
Yeah.
No, you guys are so negative. Just negative. You're the one
that gets it on YouTube every day on your comments section. They come after you.
I'm taking the heat. I don't mean it that way. Listen, I'd love to see Ottawa go 82-0. It makes our life so much easier to talk all that stuff, but that's just not reality at the moment. We got a few minutes left. I just want to ask one question about injuries. And I took some heat for people have been like, well, if you take the top two goalies out of any team and the number one center, you're going to struggle too. That's fair, but this isn't the only team that's ever dealt with injuries in its career. And I remember at one point covering the Sens when they were missing their top three centers, and it was Spezza, perhaps Bonk and Fisher, something like that, out of the lineup all at the same time, and they were still winning games. Don't forget, they were missing their top two goalies and they went on a little bit of a run we all kind of remember and talk about every once in a while. You guys deal with injuries on a regular basis. This isn't new for Ottawa.
No, it's not. But those teams were a little more veteran and had a little bit. Yeah, I was going to say they had more depth and they had a little bit more of a veteran presence. And this team just doesn't have that. This is a team that your number one center is still less than, is he 22 yet? No, he's 21. I think he just turned 21. You know, you got it. That's your number one center. And the guys behind him just don't have the experience. So, you know, apples and oranges, I guess, in the grand scheme of things. But, you take out your top two goalies. Not only are they rookie goalies, we don't know if they're either going to be NHL goalies at any point in their careers. Right. The two guys that they got back there. Right,
Pierre Dorion wrote it in his book. He wrote Sogard NHL ready in his book, he says.
Okay.
Yeah, but he was unavailable. So to go back to that Calgary game, and it's, you don't hang it on Mandalese. That's your fourth string goaltender. It's one thing to put the backups going for a long stretch. Oh shit. No, you're down to the fourth stringer. It's a depth thing. It's to me, it's down the middle. And don't forget, Norris has been a big loss.
Like, it's just huge. They don't have the goals. They don't. It's not even the goals, Wally. It's how he played at the beginning of the season. He's going out in key defensive situations. Like, he probably would have turned into the guy that your matchup center iceman. Stützle's more dynamic, but Norris is your matchup guy. So you're going to a game tonight against Edmonton. I know you don't have last change, but you're probably trying to get Norris out there against McDavid. Who are you putting out against McDavid tonight? Sure. Right?
I think you're just going to roll the lines.
Alex DeBrincat.
Yeah, you're just going to roll tonight, yeah, I think.
But again, it's they're, to answer your question, they're just so inexperienced down the middle with Norris, with the goaltending. It's a big ask, man. It's a big ask.
Bobby, if the Ottawa Senators have Cam Talbot, Anton Forsberg, and Josh Norris for a full season, are they in the playoffs?
Based on where they're sitting right now, I would say yes. They're probably in a playoff position, in a wild card spot at the moment. That would be my guess.
Yorkie?
Yeah, I'd agree with that. I would agree with that, especially this year where I keep reading that it's going to only take maybe 92, 93 points. I think they're closer to where they are. And I for sure. The only thing I'll say, though, I don't know if Stützle has the year he has if Josh Norris is healthy. That's the only thing I'll say. That's very true,
too. Yeah.
I don't think he gets 31 goals.
But in November, they weren't a playoff team, and they had their two starting goaltenders.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? We were waiting for the run. We kept saying the run was coming, and they had that little bit of a run with the 5 or 6 game win streak, and then they strung together that run after the All-Star break. I think we all knew that run was coming at some point. That really got them back into the conversation. I know we talked about it on the show. When is this run coming? It's coming, and it did. And it put them right within striking distance, and they're still there. I still think they're going to finish in, 17th place in the division or in the conference and be right on the outside looking in. But I don't know what the number of games you make up is if you put both goalies healthy all year with a healthy Josh Norris. Say it's 5 games, but that's 10 points, and that's got you in your spot right there. That's what it is.
Yeah.
Okay. Just a note, by the way, I looked up Tim Stützle. Plays on average 2 minutes more a night than any other Ottawa Senator forward. That's how reliable he's been for them this year.
Over 21 minutes. It's all about slotting. It's all about slotting. If Norris is there, Pinto is on your third line, and then your fourth line is either a Gambrell or a Brassard or a Castellick. It changes the dynamic. The slotting is so important, and that's the biggest thing it does.
Yep. I agree completely with you. I don't like to, but I agree with you.
I do too. Bang on.
Bobby's like, I got to get out of here.
The chimney guy's coming.
He's at the door right now.
It's a 32 right. degrees, boys. The fire's got to get going here.
Yeah. Get the TV turned on. It'll warm it up. All right. We'll see you on Thursday. Lots to talk about, including story time. We'll save it till Thursday. Anyway, thanks, boys. We'll talk to you. See you.
All right, Jen. See you guys. Have a good one, boys.
Yeah. Stay warm.
Coming in Hot is brought to you by Betano.ca. Please hit that like button and subscribe to our channel to never miss an episode.